I wonder if we can talk a little bit today about the things that as an artist and a filmmaker you value. So let's go right back to the beginning. And films, were they a part of childhood? Did you watch them as a family? Were your parents interested in films?
Films and television were my escape. And we weren't really like a fancy film family. That's fun to say. I really just kind of grew up rewatching like Uncle Buck and Waterboy. And, you know, I can't say that I was like a cinephile at a young age, but I loved sitcoms and watched TV nonstop. And then eventually when I was 16, 15 or 16, I got a sitcom that was on TBS. And I thought that was it, that I had made it and I had a steady paycheck. And then I ended up doing Winter's Bone on the hiatus that totally changed my career.
But I mean, all the same, that's still quite a big jump that you got into a TV show. Was there early performing as a child? Were you?
Oh yes, yes. There are many pictures of the wigs and the tutus and and I just kind of thought everybody did that. They probably do. I mean, all kids, I'm sure, kind of like watch something and then perform it for themselves and their family.
And do you remember ever seeing a screen performance or maybe a TV performance that really struck you, where you thought there's something here, some particular connection here, something that was...
I never, because I was from Kentucky, it never crossed my mind that I would ever be in a movie or a TV show. So I didn't really think of it that way. It was more of just kind of an escape. And then I didn't start thinking about acting until I was discovered when I was 14 by a modeling scout. I was much younger and thinner. And they had me do like a cold read, like a Reese's Peanut Butter Puff commercial. And I did it, and they, told my mom that was the best cold read we've ever heard, and we want her to join our agency. And my mom was like, "They're lying. They just want our money, and they didn't ask for money." And so that was like when the wheels started spinning. Like, maybe I could do this. And so we went back to Kentucky, and I couldn't even finish out the school year. I had to get back to New York, and then I ended up going to New York for the summer. And then the summer was ending, and my mother could see that this was something that was extremely important to me. And I was weird. I was like a weird artist in a small town, smallish town. I mean, Louisville's not, and she could see that I felt like I belonged and that I was happy. And so I think it was hard for her to agree with my dad that I should come back and finish out the school year. So my dad flew out to New York to bring us crazy people home. And when he got into the apartment, it was like a movie. Like, my phone rang, and I had gotten the audition for the sitcom in LA. None of us had ever been to California, and they flew us out first class. And that was, and then that was the end of that.
But that kind of assurance that allowed you to do the cold read and for them to say, can you remember what it was? Was it just obvious to you that you would become that racist?
Yeah, it was like this confidence that comes with youth that goes away probably as soon as you turn 30. I remember telling my parents, I just had no doubt that it would work. I think that can only happen with youth. I had never experienced being turned down at anything before, other than like sports, I guess. But I did. I felt so confident and sure, which I guess made an impact on my parents, who had never really seen me that, driven to something.
So who was, you had then presumably an agent or something, who was advising you on what to take? I'm interested in, because the first clip we're going to see is from Winter's Bone, which is an extraordinary independent film, but not in the realms of TV sitcoms or anything like that. So I'm interested how these things came across your radar.
I had an agency. I think my first agency was CESD, and then my second agency after I got the sitcom was CAA. So I was able to read a lot of stuff, and my parents used to get very upset with me because when I would go, I remember, like, I think I got invited to, like, meet the vice president of, like, Disney or something. And in the meeting, I was like, I don't think I'm a Disney kid. And my parents, who are, like, mortgaging our farm, you know, are like, you did what? And so I was like, I had somewhere in my brain an idea of something. Again, just that youthful confidence, I guess, being my compass.
So Winter's Bone then comes. Is that something you picked out when you, from reading other stuff as well?
Yes, and I auditioned, and then they moved on without me, and they moved casting to New York. So naturally, I flew to New York and just signed in again like a stranger and was like, hello, nice to meet you. And broke them down until they hired me.
So what was it that I mean, just for anybody who hasn't seen Winter's Bone, this is from a Daniel Woodrell story, isn't it? And it's kind of, he's the author of what's sometimes called Ozark Gothic, isn't he? So this is a very deprived family with a lot of problems, crystal meth and various other dysfunctional problems. And you are the daughter who's trying to hold it together.
There's a lot that I identify with now that I'm older and I'm looking back at the movies that I was connected to. I think leaving home at such a young age, I felt forced to grow up very, very quickly and was kind of my own parent for a while. And I think that comes through on more than just Winter's Bone, and just kind of grappling with that. I don't know how to end the sentence.
No, you don't need to, because I think what we'll do is we'll show the clip. And this is where your character, he's called Ree. Ree is trying to hold together, the father has gone missing, and Ree is trying to hold together the whole situation, particularly for her younger siblings. But the mother is really not a great deal of help for all sorts of reasons her own. Could we see the Winter's Bone clip, please?
There's things happening, and I don't know what to do. Can you please help me this one time? Mom. Mom, look at me. Teardrop thinks I should sell the woods, Mom. Should I sell? Please help me this one time. I don't know what to do.
I mean, it was a performance of extraordinary maturity, because there's so much that this 17-year-old has to cope with. What kind of preparation for it? I remember talking at the time to Deborah Granick, the director, about, you know, her process, and I assume that would mean that you would have been somehow kind of immersed into that whole area and community.
I was. It was very immersive, and kind of very much blending what was happening in reality and what Deborah was filming. It was very authentic. I mean, that house, you know, I had stayed and not slept there, but had stayed there for weeks before we started shooting and getting to know the people that were going to be in the film, and yeah, that was very, a very unique process.
So, I mean, in terms of, apart from acting on the kind of instinct that you suggest, you know, was the way that you were working, were the things that you absorbed about other people's experience as well?
Probably not. I mean, I was young. I was probably just only focused on myself, I would assume. It's such a unique place in America, the Ozarks, and the lives there are very unique. So, I don't think it would have been possible to be authentic in that performance without some knowledge and some time spent with the people we're portraying.
It's fascinating film because it's both ultra realist and it also has this kind of mythical, like classical Greek story feel to it as well, which allowed you to have a huge range of kind of registers and emotions all the way through. So did you feel that you learned a lot on it?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yeah, I think I had done one movie before that that Lori Petty directed, and that was a huge learning experience. And Deborah's technique is so unique that it was, again, it was hard to know what was real and what was, you know, she didn't cut for a very long time, or the camera would just kind of come up and capture something that was really happening. It was extremely immersive.
And were there rehearsals, or was it sort of workshopped, or, I mean, do you like rehearsals?
I don't mind. I normally take the cue from the director on what they, Darren for Mother was very, felt very strongly about rehearsals. And we were like in a warehouse and we had like a blueprint tape of the house. He wanted to, you know, to rehearse every single second. And then, you know, sometimes it's better to just, you know, do something on the day. God, I can't remember if we rehearsed a lot for, I don't think so. I think the rehearsal was just time spent with this family.
Yeah. And the, of course, then it gets 4 Academy Award nominations, including one for leading actress. I mean, what was the effect of that?
Shock. Just complete shock. I mean, this movie, we had one red camera, you know. We all shared one van. Like, no, it was the budget was so minuscule. It's funny. I'm experiencing a similar shock with Causeway because it was just so, you know, 3.5 years and just one challenge after the other that you're just like, and it was so personal that it feels impossible that people will understand it or get it or care or connect to it. They both feel that way, that like, what, how? I guess Causeway more than Winter's Bone, it almost feels like diary pages. So when people react to them, it's like, I don't know how to describe the feeling other than it's surprising.
So you had this huge amount of attention with all the awards that and the great success and critical acclaim of Winter's Bone. But then as far as I can see from the next kind of big role that comes along is your Mystique. You're in an X-Men film.
I think Hunger Games. Oh, wait, no, you're right. The X-Men was, oh, you did your research. Okay. All right. Tried to trick me.
Yeah, it was interesting to see. But, okay, we are going to talk about Hunger Games in a moment.
No, it's okay. I'm not, like, desperate to talk. We can talk about X-Men.
We will. I cannot imagine two more different things than Mystique and Ree in Winter's Bone. So you were like, okay, should we swing to the other end of the pendulum? Was that
I just never thought I would be offered like a superhero movie. I thought that was like a huge opportunity. And I loved superhero movies and loved the X-Men movies. So that was a thrill. And franchises they're so fun. And I think I could never do one now because I'm just too old and brittle, but just making the friendships that you make on those are just, you know.
And just the endurance of what, 7 hours in makeup or whatever to turn into the.
Yeah, eight. who was counting? Yeah, it was fun. My one hang up before I said yes to the movies was, you know, the actress, Rebecca Romijn, who played Mystique before, she had like something insane, like 12 hours of makeup or something, where you're already in overtime before you even get to set. And I was like, I don't want to do that. I would like a suit. And they were like, absolutely. And then I get on set and they're like, it's paint. But I did get a suit for the next two movies. And then it's normal. You're just walking around virtually naked in pantyhose.
But how much energy do you have left for acting after all that?
None. But it's okay because nobody can really see your face.
But the reach and influence of those franchises has been extraordinary in the 20th century, hasn't it? I mean, I can't think of... I mean, I guess maybe the generation before, maybe my generation are, it was TV series that we loved. But from Lord of the Rings onwards, there's just been this absolute, I mean, do you find it understandable, startling? I mean, what do you think of it?
I think it's totally understandable. I love them too. I think this generation understandably likes a world, you know, to escape to. And I relate to that.
As Mystique, what did you have people, did you find that was she affecting people in kind of, was it surprising the effect that she had?
Yeah, I mean, the biggest surprise was I was in my, you know, when very much an indie actress before this movie came out. And then as soon as I was cast as Mystique, I was in a hotel in New York and I left and there was like three people like taking pictures, you know, on those old thin digital cameras, and somebody said, don't take a picture of Mystique in human form. And I was like, I don't know what I just signed up for. Am I in human form?
Well, that's right. There's that whole kind of protocol and language and whatever. Anyway, but Hunger Games follows swift upon that. And in some ways, you can see more of a line from Winter's Bone to Hunger Games, can't you, in that it's... So did you know the novels, the young adult novels?
Yeah, I had read them and obviously loved them. Auditioned, got the part, and then took a minute to think about it because the Twilight movies had already been released, and so I could see how, you know, there was this new... fandom that was really intense. It was like fame on an entirely different level. And that just wasn't how I pictured my life. I kind of pictured, you know, first sitcom and then like, oh, maybe I can do indies. You know, I just kind of pictured myself kind of flying under the radar. And so that was, you know, I knew that I was fortunate to have the Twilight movies to kind of base it off of, to kind of be like, to prepare. And then I knew that I would regret it forever if I didn't do it. And I certainly don't regret doing them.
So what kind of preparation can you do for that kind of fame?
I mean, it was weird. It was, you know, I took a few days, then I said yes. And once I said yes, you know, there's no going back. I do recall, because I knew that you were going to show this clip, when I was doing the I volunteer scene. Sorry to give that away. She's going to show that scene. I remember that being like a moment where I was like just kind of future escaping. Like, what is it going to be like? Like, what if I can't go anywhere? What if I like, will I drive a car? Will I always be driven? Like, you know, just kind of like musing. And then I realized that I'm a homebody and all I'm ever doing is seeking excuses to not do something and to just stay at home. And then I realized that this is kind of the best excuse ever because I can get out of anything. I can be like, I'm just too famous to go. and that was kind of, I just remember that scene ending in that thought. And then I was like, okay.
Well, we'll try not to let that undermine our viewing now, the clip of the...
Yeah, forget that.
We'll forget that. But if we could possibly see the volunteering scene, please, from Hunger Games. Thanks.
Primrose Everdeen. Where are you? Come on up. Well, come on up. volunteer as tribute.
I believe we have a volunteer. Mr. Mayor.
I need to get out of here. You need to get out of here.
No.
Go find Mom.
No.
Grim, go find Mom right now.
No.
So sorry.
No.
Go find Mom.
No.
Grim, leave. Go find Mom.
No. 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 No.
Dramatic turn of events here in District 12.
Yes, well, District 12's very first volunteer. Bring her up.
Come on, dear.
What's your name?
Agnes Everdeen.
Well, I bet my hat that was your sister, wasn't it?
Yes.
Let's have a big hand for our very first volunteer, Katniss Everdeen. And now, for the boys.
It is a terrific example, actually, of how that film and that franchise, particularly actually in that sequence, gets so much sort of 20th century history into a popular entertainment format and gives it all of the impact of that.
Suzanne Collins says that she came up with the idea from flipping from the news to a reality television show, And it's sad and heartbreaking how many times we have to watch what happens, you know, when you let democracy slip from your fingers. That's depressing.
So that goes on till 2015. I mean, not as long as, of course, X-Men are going to go on till 2019. I mean, they've only really just gone away. But aside from that, you are looking at all sorts of other possibilities. And it's in that very same year that I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but that same year that you're doing Hunger Games that you also come across David O. Russell.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I think I had just finished Hunger Games. I went pretty much straight from Hunger Games to Silver Linings Playbook. And I mean, talk about a learning experience. That was, I think, like, so much of my education came from David, and I was so young that I was so perfect to just kind of be molded in this, you know, way that, you know, he just kind of talks during takes and just, no, that's not good. No, oh, it's bullshit. And Bradley one time was like, are you like okay? Like, he said that's bullshit. And I was like, no, that means he just wants me to use a lower register in my voice. And and then off we went.
But he took, I mean, you talk about having two sets of auditions for Deborah Granick, but he took some persuading, I think, because the character in Silver Linings Playbook was originally conceived as a much older woman.
Yes, I was only 21 when we were shooting that movie. It was written for somebody probably in their 30s, and the actresses that they were looking at were older. But we got on a Zoom, or a whatever it used to be called, that's now Zoom, and hit it off. And we read together and, I don't know, talked, and I guess I changed his mind.
Do you say that it was a learning experience? But you clearly, I mean, right from those early cold reads, you had that kind of confidence that I can do this.
Yeah. I don't know. I didn't really ever know what I was doing, and I think that served me. I think that I still get very nervous before I start a movie. Like 3 days before, I just get this stomach drop. Like, what if I can't act? What if I don't know how to do this? You know, and I think if I had a process, that would be really helpful. I'd be like, trust the process and do the process, and then that'll work. And I just never have found one. And I didn't really understand what I was doing at any point in time. And when I finished Silver Linings, I was convinced that that was the worst performance of my life. And I think now, in retrospect, it was because if I had tried to intellectualize it and kind of meet David with that, it just wouldn't have gone anywhere. Instead, I was just kind of this open kind of ball of clay that I didn't really need to understand why my character was doing this in this scene. He would say things like, do it in slow motion. And then all of it, you know, the diner scene ended up being extremely seductive, you know, when I'm describing how I got fired from my job. And it was not written that way. He said, do it in slow motion. And so I just did it in slow motion. And then when you watch it, you see that she's seducing him. I didn't know.
But maybe he did.
Somewhere.
But of course, the thing about David O. Russell films is that they do defy genre and all that. And that sometimes that some people find that difficult. But with Silver Linings, it's absolutely that great example of, you know, it's a bit comedy, but it's also, and do you like that, the way that, you know, when things do escape, as it were, from baskets?
I love that. And there's, I mean, my personal favorite genre is any kind of dark comedy. I was a huge fan of David O. Russell before Silver Linings. And I Heart Huckabees is one of my favorite. I think that's like easily one of the top five funniest movies. And because it's just so pure and unpolluted and random. Yes, I do like a cross genre.
Well, let's see an example now from Silver Linings Playbook of your character really kind of stepping up to the mark here.
Who is this?
We need
Who's
to talk
this?
Right now. When you make a serious commitment to somebody, it is not cool to not show up.
Wait a second. I tried to call. Oh my God, what's
Who is
happening?
This?
I tried to call you, Tiffany.
Really?
Yes.
I told you I was going to split my time with my dad and you, and my dad was pulling me in one direction. Dr. Patel,
well, that
Ronnie.
That sounds great, Pat. That's great for all of them, but all of them didn't make a commitment to me in return for my help. I'm Tiffany, by the way.
What is this craziness with Tiffany Maxwell?
There's no craziness. I told you who she was. I was doing this thing with her. We had a conversation.
Fucking nuts. When you started spending time with her, it all fell apart. This is the fucking reason right here.
You think I fucked up all the Eagles juju, don't you?
Ever since he was with you. Ever since
you
he was...
You think that I'm why today's happened.
That's right. You are why today's
I'm the
happened.
Reason why You're... today happened.
I think so.
Let's talk about that.
Be my guest.
The first night that Pat and I met at my sister's, the Eagles beat the 49ers handily 40-26. The second time we got together, we went for a run, and the Phillies beat the Dodgers 7-5 in the NLCS.
She's right, Dad.
The next time we went for a run, the Eagles beat the Falcons 27-14.
Wow.
The third time we got together, we had Raisin Bran in the diner, and the Phillies dominated Tampa Bay in the fourth game of the World Series 10-2.
Oh, wow. Fascinating.
Well, let me think about that. Wait a minute.
Well, why don't you think about when the Eagles beat the Seahawks 14-7?
He was with you?
He was with me. We went for a run.
Really?
That's crazy.
There have been no games since Pat and I have been rehearsing every day, and if Pat had been with me like he was supposed to, he wouldn't have gotten in a fight, he wouldn't be in trouble, maybe the Eagles beat the New York Giants.
She's making a lot of sense, Pop. That's all right on all accounts.
Does anybody here happen to know what the official motto of the state of New York is on the official seal of the state of New York?
Mm-mm.
Huh? Anybody? Do you know?
No.
Excelsior. Oh. Look it up.
Really?
What?
Yeah. Excelsior.
Oh, Pat.
Not that I give a fuck about football or about your superstitions, but if it's me reading the signs, I don't send the Eagles guy, whose personal motto is Excelsior, to a fucking Giants game, especially when he's already in a legal situation.
Unbelievable.
Wow. How did you know all that stuff?
I did my research.
You know, it's all the time, it's the little asides, it's obviously it's your performance as well, but it's just that is the whole thing about a David O. Russell film, isn't it? That it's just those layers come through all the time.
Yeah, I mean, it's so, he sees something in everything and is so kind of true, you know, just follows that, like even just like rewatching that, Pat,
yeah,
from his mom after she hears that Excelsior is the New York motto. Oh, Pat, like it's just, and he's balancing so many characters in his head at the same time. It's, remarkable.
But for you to have a scene that is at least in part against De Niro. I mean, that must have been just a little bit intimidating.
Just a little. And I am not good at homework. I don't look at the next day when I'm filming. Normally that's fine, especially when I was 21, you know. I woke up, that was my, I was like, oh, fuck. Because memorizing like a train of thought is fine, you know. We went to the diner and we did, you know, blah, blah, blah. But sports, numbers, stats, not, And so I did my best. I believe you'd have to double check with David because I don't want to tell falsities, but I think that this is true. But I, you know, I'm memorizing. I'm in the car, I'm panicking, you know, all action. And I get it on the first shot and then don't get it at any point after that. Just take after take after take of just like,
but and De Niro is there and
yeah, he's he's there, but he's, I mean, he's a warm, sweet person. I mean, it's, you know, obviously it's very intimidating, but as soon as you meet him, he tells you, you know, call me Bob. And so it's hard to be intimidated by when you're calling him Bob, you know, like who's mean that's named Bob? Like Bob's obviously like a nice, sweet guy.
It worked. I mean, it all worked so well. And an Oscar then.
Yeah, still. I kept thinking, I wonder when it's going to like hit me. I don't think it like ever will. It's just, you know, yeah, extremely overwhelming.
Did it make you review what you might want to do from there on?
Not really. I think... when I'm, I think eventually I lost a sense of control. I think that I got, you know, with between Hunger Games coming out and winning the Oscar, I think that I became such kind of a commodity that I felt like every decision was a big, big group decision. 'Cause I had no idea what, you know, what a huge movie star does next or what, you know, Katniss Everdeen should do after this or, you know. And I don't know, when I reflect now, I kind of think of those following years as just kind of a loss of control and then a reaction to try to get it back and, you know, kind of do a movie like that. And then I'm so happy that I eventually, finally, in my late 20s, stopped and left the agency that I was with and made some major changes. And then I finally kind of got the voice in my head back, I feel like. And now I'm able to, it feels personal to me again for the first time in a long time.
Yeah, well, I want to talk about Causeway just in a moment. But I mean, it's not as if, I mean, you did some interesting things in those years. I mean, you've tried all kinds of genres and really some, you know, Mother is a really interesting film. Some people really hate it, but it's...
Oh, yeah.
But it's a turn, and others relate to it entirely. So, you know, it wasn't as if you were just following the same kind of format. You were trying different things.
Yeah, I would definitely say Mother was my reaction to like, you can't tell me what to do.
But by withdrawing a bit, you've been able to... I mean, obviously, if you've had a child as well, but you've been able to sit and think about what you do. Now, you have your own production company, mm-hmm. which has a terrific name, which is...
Excellent Cadaver.
Which means...
Well, it's a Sicilian mafia term for a hit on a major celebrity, which just made sense. And yeah, I think there was part of me that wanted to just execute that part of me. I have to go. It's also just an interesting group of words, but... yes, that is the name of my production company.
And the first... production that has actually come to screen is Causeway, which is showing here, which is a really interesting film for all sorts of reasons. I really liked it, but it's certainly not a kind of celebrity-driven film in any way, although you have two very strong actors, yourself and Brian Terry Henry, in the main roles. But it is it's in a completely different register. I mean, it's more akin to Winter's Bone, I guess.
Yes. Yeah, it felt serendipitous to have the first film on my production company, be an independent. And, you know, that's where I got my roots, and that's, you know, what I can, you know, attribute my entire career to. And, you know, the best part about producing so far is just like, I can just fan out. You know, I'm developing something with Lynn Ramsey. I'm obsessed with Lynn Ramsey. I've always wanted to work with Lynn Ramsey. And Lila was just so clearly perfect.
This is the director.
This is Lila Neugebauer, first-time director. And we went to dinner that ended up being 5 hours long. And she was brilliant, and she has instincts. And so the most important part to me is, as the producer of the film, was to touch and do as little as possible, but just to make sure that Lila had the creative freedom, you know, that she needed, and the confidence that she needed to be able to execute her job. You know, I wanted her to have the DOP that she wanted and the editor that she wanted. And she has very sharp instincts. I felt like my only job was to protect them.
And it's a really... it's a really intelligent film about trauma. So your character is a war veteran who is severely traumatized because of a brain injury. But we don't have to have a flashback, or we don't have to have too much explanation about it. What we're really interested in is how she's dealing with it in that moment.
Yeah, I mean, it's a movie about PTSD told completely in the present. And that wasn't always how it started. The script has been, we've, you know, stripped it apart, put it back together. It's just, we had a 2-year hiatus in between. And we shot a lot of Afghanistan. And then in the edit room, it just didn't feel right. And Lila, again, following her instincts, just stripped away until there was, I think, like one... It was just beautiful because it was shot on 16, and it was just kind of like a flare in the sky. And I was hesitating to let go of it just because I thought that it was kind of like a visually beautiful punctuation at the end of this one scene. And so we were, you know, disagreeing about it. And she just said, I want to make a film about war and about the past that's told completely in the present. And I was like, sick. Yes, you're right. Okay.
And central to it is this friendship, this connection between her and somebody who is a sort of, she didn't actually know before, but he's kind of connected to her old life. I loved the rhythm of those scenes. I loved the sense of, I mean, was that partly improvised? Or?
Improvised in a way, not in the sense that like, not you're not on set, improvising your own lines. But we had a lot of, say over the dialogue before we would shoot the scenes. So, you know, Brian and I did this on our own, I don't know, halfway through the pandemic outside, according to guidelines, of just, it's almost like therapy, but therapy for your character and, you know, what they're going through, how they would react to something like that, which is especially really interesting when you're doing a fight and, you know, like an argument scene, and you know how you would react, but you're like, but you don't have the same past traumas that this person does. And so it was improv in the sense that we talked it all out, and then it was written up, and then it was set, but not, you know, on the day of. But then there were also days where we were like, none of this makes sense, scrap it, okay, let's do it, and then flip it all over again. I've never made a film like that in my life, and I think I would die if I had to do it again. But it was obviously worth it.
But it also, it struck me, and I mean, this may be a kind of mad theory, but that it actually, it has quite a contemporary film feel, in that we're also used to sort of Western drama and the kind of rhythms and beats of the way that, and yet you also see that there's films like Drive My Car and, you know, Iranian films, or that people are appreciating that there is something extra you can get from that.
Yeah, the first thing that I fell in love with in the script, or I guess maybe the original novella, Red, White, and Water, was the melody of it. Was just this slow, melodic rhythm that just brings forward performance, and that's I love making those kind of movies. I love watching those kinds of movies. I also love superhero movies as much as the next person. But yeah, it had been so long since I had read something with a melody like that.
And it has a kind of, apart from an emotional resonance, it has a kind of political resonance as well, without making it explicit. And I think it made me wonder a bit about, you know, the political effect of him. Obviously, you also made Don't Look Up recently, which is...
And Mother. And that was the environment.
But that, you know, you believe that film has the potential to have kind of political... I mean, I don't mean political, party political, but a force for change?
Soft power? I don't know. I it feels so therapeutic when you're doing it, because you feel, you're like... How is this not going to make sense? You know, how is this not going to change minds or inspire or something? You know, and then it comes out and it's like, well, everybody just kind of, you know, throws their popcorn away and drives away in their Ford F-150s. And honestly, the truth is there isn't a whole lot that, you know, we personally can do to help climate change. It's, you know, not having a lot of effect on our government is the biggest problem, not being able to control money in politics. But yes and no. Clearly, I believed that and felt strongly because I made two films about the environment. Now I'm making a film that's just hilarious because I'm also just like, let's just have 2 hours where we just, you know, laugh and forget that the world is falling apart.
So what's this?
It's called No Hard Feelings, and it's actually written and directed by my very good friend. I've been friends with him for like 15 years, Gene Stupnetsky. And it is based on a 2007 Craigslist ad where a woman is looking for a girl to date her son before he goes to college because she's worried about his confidence. And I am a 32-year-old woman who reads this ad, but I need a car, which is the reward for dating her son. And he's 19. He's played by Andrew Barth Feldman, who is incredible. And yeah, basically, I'm trying to fuck this kid as quickly as possible to get this car, which has, I mean, we go late sometimes because we can't get through scenes. And it's been really fun, and I'm very excited for people to see it.
And more productions, I mean, will you be working more with your own production company?
Is that yes, true? I'm producing that, yeah.
So is that, you think, the way to go for now? Is just...
I don't have a stuck kind of, these are the kind of movies that I want to make. I always kind of open everything with fresh, you know, right now I'm rereading a book that I read when I was 19 that for some reason has just always been stuck in the ethers, and I don't understand how it would be a movie or a miniseries or anything, but it's still stuck. So I'm rereading it and going through and kind of trying to understand where that's coming from. And that's like, it's Whiteacre. It's by Philippa Gregory, who wrote The Other Berlin Girl. And it turned out to be her first novel, which I didn't know. And like, I don't know what that would be. Like a Downton Abbey, you know, I have no idea, but you know, ever forward.
No, but if it sticks with you, that's the
thing. Yeah, it's more personal now.
Great. Well, it's been terrific talking to you over this hour, and really grateful for this. Causeway, this is the voice we're going to leave everybody. I'm going to ask you all to stay in your seats for the trailer for Causeway, which we're showing in just a second. So Causeway is showing tonight. You're going to do the red carpet shortly,
yes.
I think, for that. And then it's showing during the week. But then it's going to be on Apple?
Yes, it'll be streaming on Apple November 4th, Matt? Is it November 4th? Pure guess.
In stereo, the answer came back, yes. So I would urge you all to see it. It's a really, really interesting film. But in the meantime, Jennifer Lawrence, for this screen talk, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hey, you good? Look, if it get dark, you know, you just ride it, okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How do I do that?
All right, what's dark?
Being back here.
You don't got love for this city? Thank you.
It's not the city.
You know what it is?